So the idea of this BOF is to discuss the instruments, of the community instruments that we have today. We have a code of conduct since about a year, and we have a statement, what's it called again?
Diversity statement.
Thank you, sorry about that. Sorry, Madam Zhu. We have a diversity statement since about 2 years. The idea here is to discuss what we have, see if it's working well, maybe see if we need something more. And if there are issues that we have, general issues, we can talk about them. But I would like to stress that the idea is not to be talking about particular issues in much detail. I would prefer that we don't start pointing things at people. Everybody can have a bad day, everybody can be badly tempered sometimes, and talking about how blah blah did something wrong 3 months ago is not going to help anyone. So I would like to stress that. Having said that, I know that when the code of conduct was voted into existence, there was a number of people who opposed it, and I must say it was something that surprised me. I would have expected some opposition, but the number was higher than I originally thought it would be. So just for starters, is there anybody in the room who voted against the code of conduct?
Let me phrase it that
no,
way.
No, I was silent.
I have voted for the code of conduct.
Yeah.
But seeing what happened based on the code of conduct afterwards made me wish I wouldn't have voted for it.
Well, that would have been my next question, actually. But there's nobody in the room then who voted against it, if I get it right. Is that correct? Right. So my next question is indeed, would somebody in the room have voted differently with the things they know today? So that's you, somebody else? Nobody. Okay. Karsten, would you please explain then why you think that way?
It gets a bit longish, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
For me, the code of conduct represents a role model, something to strive for.
Yeah.
Which is fine and sensible in my eyes.
Uh-huh.
Unfortunately, my impression, needs to share that, but that is my impression. Some people view the code of conduct as a stick to beat up people they don't agree with. This is very shortened.
Right.
But there is the basic problem that things that are completely innocent for a person to say without bad intentions create the impression of being aggressive or abusing on people often coming from other cultural circles. I'm definitely not going to point fingers. We had several cases where somebody said something, not even thinking of it being insulting
right,
to somebody.
Yeah.
Because it is a common colloquial expression
where they come from. Right.
But people who read that felt severely insulted by it without it meant to be insulting.
Right.
And things have been pushing up each other after that.
Right.
And also there are things like somebody making, let's say, some sloppy expression which somebody else actually read as being physically threatened with physical violence.
I haven't seen that, but yeah.
Happened as well.
You're talking about buses.
I'm talking, among other things, also about buses, yes.
Right, yeah.
Right.
If you live in the same area as the person who used the bus, you clearly see that it was an innocent joke, but for the recipient it did not appear to be an innocent joke, but he actually felt threatened. And this is something that I find hardly to avoid in an international project, because they're just cultural differences. Often there are expressions which to a native speaker are completely innocent, but the impression a non-native speaker gets is different. And things start piling up then, and I'm not sure that is something that can actually be avoided. I'm a, just one sentence, I'm actually a fan of the IATF principle. Be conservative in what you send and be liberal in what you accept.
I want to maybe pull back a little bit from the idea that a code of conduct is going to avoid all conflict or all people providing offense, and propose that maybe one way to think about the code of conduct is
right. Can somebody take notes, please, because I can't do both.
I'm trying,
you're trying to. Okay.
I would like someone to
help you out.
Right.
Sorry. Yeah.
Sorry
go
to interrupt.
Okay.
I'm just very new, and I know is that like a Titan pad?
It's Gobi. So you do Gobi, and you connect to. Is it Gobi? Oh, that's fine. You install that, and then you connect to gobi.debian.org.
Okay. I'll do it on
the
text file. I'll give it to you later.
That works too.
Thank you, both of you for taking that.
Sorry, go ahead.
So I was just going to say that I think we like to, as you know, technical geeks and process geeks, we like to try to come up with ways that we can prevent all of the bad things from ever happening, right? Like we're doing sort of defensive programming in our social environment. And I want to say that maybe sometimes it's worth thinking about the code of conduct not as a way to prevent something bad from happening, because as you say, given the international nature of the project, that's probably impossible because we have all of these different people coming together, but instead see the code of conduct as a way of saying, hey, sometimes bad things will happen because maybe someone says something unintentionally that turned out to offend or insult someone, and the code of conduct can be a way that we can come together and say, oh, I screwed up. Will you forgive me for screwing up? I'll try to not do it again because now I understand where you're coming from differently. So rather than seeing it as a way that we can, you know, beat people up for making a mistake, for doing something innocently that you know, hurt somebody else's feelings or discourage other people from participating, we can see it as a way to say, look, we're committed towards working together across these complicated international boundaries that we for sure can't get right all the time. And it's a way to say, oh, like, we can take responsibility for the things that we didn't mean to do even, and grow and work together in that sort of community way. So to not see it explicitly as we're going to prevent all bad things from happening, because I agree, we're going to fail, that's our goal. But instead say, how do we acknowledge when bad things happen and move forward in a way that builds the community instead of tearing
it
apart?
I think, yeah.
I think, because I remember the case in question, and it was at the end of a lot of things going wrong in the discussion. And it's a bit like writing a program to handle the condition of the computer being on fire. And there's little that the program can do. The problem is that the computer is on fire. So, I mean, it's perfectly okay to talk about bus factor in normal debit conversation. I mean, what if I get hit by a bus, who's going to maintain an end of your right? I don't think there's a problem with that. But in a normal conversation, I totally accept that people say, what if you get hit by a bus? But in a conversation where things are heated, where I totally lost trust on the good intentions of the person in front of me, and if somebody tells me, what if you are hit by a bus, then I was like, I would like go away. And please never be seen next to a bus in my presence. But the problem there is not the expression, is that there is the loss of the trust that I have on that person to actually care to actually value that my existence on the planet is an addition rather than a problem. And at that point, I'm not sure how much code of conduct or something about behavior can do, and I totally agree, I would be totally interested in figuring out how to take that as a point of growth. Like, it's not a problem in a relationship to end up in a situation of conflict, but in a healthy relationship, it's nice that there's a way to say, oh wow, we are in a situation of conflict. How did we get there? What was the actual problem? Rather than, oh, you said that, but you said that.
Right.
Yes, I'm very new to Debian at large, and I'm here because I'm helping to organize DevConf 2016 next year.
Right.
So I've been hit first with the problems in Augur, which I think is very much probably an intensification of the problems generally. Okay. A lot of this is happening. So I've two questions. One is, it feels like there's some people, probably native speakers, who are more dominant, and the non-native speakers already feel marginalized. So it really links up to what Enrico was saying, that it's not about the expressions, but that you're feeling marginalized as a point of departure.
Right.
Are the marginalized communities involved in writing things like the code of conduct? That's my first question.
That's a good question.
If you feel you don't belong to a place, so marginalized maybe, and then someone writes something to help protect you, but you weren't involved in it, that's patronizing and useless. So I want to know if people were involved in creating the structures that should protect them.
The code of conduct, I wrote an initial draft, and it was then discussed over mailing lists and over above last, 2 years ago during DevConf. I tried to be as inclusive as possible about that, but of course it's impossible to say you have to help me. I did try to listen to people who had disagreements. Sometimes I agreed with them, sometimes I didn't agree with them. But I think I did try to do that. I'm not sure if it actually happened, though. That's maybe a good question. That intent actually happened, if it did actually happen, that people who felt marginalized felt included. Maybe that's one of the reasons why more people voted against the code of conduct than I was hoping for. I don't know. Does anybody have a deep idea about that? Apparently not.
I can't remember whether I voted against it. I think I abstained.
You can look this up if you want me to.
Go ahead.
Right.
I was teetering on the brink of doing so, I think. Or maybe I had a nice day and voted for it. But do you want to point at the camera? I don't know. I'd like to do that.
Was there a reason why you said that?
So the reason I would have voted against it is the same the reason that I would have voted against there being a DPL if I voted in that, which is that I don't think that these structures really work in this sort of organisation. But the optimism of the thing, I think that's why I'm saying it's because, it could work, so let people play with it, but I think it's been quite often used as a weapon, because we like in certain people, depending on their culture, like interpreting suggestions as rules, or, Americans seem to think everything needs to be written down in the Constitution and then it's set in stone. English people tend to think that if you haven't actually been told not to on pain of death, then it's probably allowed. And Germans, if there is a rule about it, then it must be forbidden. So if you don't have any innocuous statement that you're going to try and put in a place that's a bit like a rule book, then you're going to get three completely at odds interpretations of that, at least. That's only three nations. Throw in the Japanese who haven't got a word for no.
Right.
So we have a problem.
Just for the record, you voted 1, 2, 3, which means you voted for it. So you did not vote against it.
Okay. I must have been feeling optimistic that day.
I wanted to go back to the using as a stick or as weapon.
Uh-huh.
I think it's in some part just very natural. People fall back to authorities, sometimes malicious as weapon, but more often innocuously, because they just have, especially if they are not very sure and have problems to convince people, they grab everything they see as authority and throw it at the other side. It's not only code of conduct. For example, one often sees it with the list of fallacies,
right,
which is a useful tool to see what it is, but in the end, you often see people just
telling the other people what fallacies they assume they just have told, instead of arguing about what they do.
That's
and I think with the it happens with everything, and a code of conduct will be used this way. If there wasn't a code of conduct, people would use something else there. And I think there is also the thing that if the other side uses something like this perceived as a weapon, it's too easy to see it as malicious on the other side, that they use it as a weapon. I think it might also help there to see it as that there is just an uncertainty, an anxiety in them that causes them to grab the next thing of authority. For example, in some heated discussions with some newcomers, we all knew sometimes they will throw in Debian Free Software Guidelines number sowieso.
Right.
At which point you know he is just
trying to make an argument.
No, it's their emotions got
right.
over them. They cared about something and the emotions got over their head.
Right.
And I think with the other points where people use where you see that people use it as a stick, it would also more important to perceive this more or try to perceive this more that it is most likely more that they are also too much in emotion, that they are unsure.
Maybe
about
try to
it.
Find a way to help them calm down actually.
Yes.
That's probably what you should be going.
I read the code of conduct now, and
mm-hmm.
I was thinking about the detailed discussion, like in couple or like the system D discussion, or
right.
is it system D?
Well, I think the system D thing itself is it's unfortunate that we voted the code of conduct into existence in the midst of the system D thing.
Right.
But anyway, go ahead.
So, and I was trying to see. So in those heated discussions, there are patterns that are probably not addressed in the code of conduct. The code of conduct is mostly about the average everyday conversation. So when we are all nice and peaceful and fine, this kind of says how to keep it nice and simple and fine. And then things spiral out of control. And I was thinking about the situations where things spiral out of control, and I think one problem we have is that it's things in which the participants are uncomfortable being there, but they see no alternative to being there.
Right.
In other examples of interaction that we have in mind, there are ways of getting out, but no means no. I would like to discuss this with you, but now it's not a good time for me. Let's bring it up after I had breakfast, so I don't feel like murdering you.
Right.
Or, these kind of things are quite normal, and but in a mailing list, we do not have that. The possibility of safe wording out, of saying, I care about that, but I don't feel comfortable discussing it in these terms. There's the general feeling that if I bail out because I'm uncomfortable, then my voice will not be represented.
Right.
And so at that point, the rules of the conversation change. And then things go weird. Like there could be abuse by pleasantness. Like, I care a lot, I get heated because I'm uncomfortable, I'm out of my comfort zone, I get defensive and everything. And somebody else who can see that as an opportunity to be nice to me in a way that becomes abusive. Like, oh, but why are you so heated? You are getting so uncivilized about these things. And suddenly they take the moral high, that they kind of win by moral high ground, but in
right,
a way
right.
that's twisted.
So, it's basically what you're saying is that we should maybe try to figure out a way of seeing if we can do something about that, or
yeah, the code of conduct doesn't seem to offer ways out.
Right.
For when somebody is out of the comfort zone. But
is that something we should add to the code of conduct?
So I see this as a relationship. I see most things as a relationship. So
right.
When in trouble, ask for relationship counseling. Which is very, it could be from very basic things. My first go-to thing is always like, when you say that, I feel this. Which can get nasty when the other person is being a bully, because then they start mocking you. But often I feel like that's, often the other person goes, oh no, I don't know, and then it already resolves.
Right.
So my question was, is the code of conduct too general that everything just slips through the cracks? So I would definitely suggest adding very specific counseling things, like try doing this, try asking, you know, or try telling the other person, if you say that, I feel this. You know, some
right,
simple
right.
tools. And it feels stupid when you look at it, but it actually is very useful.
Right.
I'm not sure I agree with Enrico about not getting out, or because I think that when you are in minority or underrepresented group and you are not feeling comfortable with language or with heated discussions, and you also see that other people are using code of conduct as a stick, it might mean that some minorities will tend to draw out either from discussion or even from project, because
yeah.
they are afraid that you will they will be misunderstood because of heated discussion, because of their not being proficient enough with language, and then they will be afraid that even though they mean well, the code of conduct will be used as a stick against them, so they will use and then they will.
Is that maybe something we should try to work on? If you see people use the code of conduct as a stick and you're not involved in the discussion, it's maybe a good idea to step in and say, hey, please don't do that, because that's not what it's for. Does that sound reasonable?
Yeah, but I think that happened in the discussions where that was said as well, right?
Yes, it did happen.
The code of conduct was used as a stick and people said it's not a stick.
And
it didn't help resolving the use of the stick.
Right, I was just wondering.
What I was going to say is that there's kind of two principles which seem sort of contradictory. So on one hand, there's the code of conduct, which is can be read as don't do this, don't do that. And on the other hand, there's the kind of older principle of always assume a good intent, which is so important that it's actually right at the top of the code of conduct, so assuming good intent. And so when you were talking about, someone mentioned being conservative with what you send and being liberal with what you receive, I feel like those two principles, one can be applied to one and the other. So in terms of what you send, one can use the code of conduct to think about what they are saying to others. But then when you are interpreting what you hear from other people, then it's best not to use the code of conduct, but rather to use the principle of always assuming good intent. So I feel like if there's a separation between when you hear stuff, don't use the code of conduct to police what other people are saying, but only use it to police what you yourself are saying. And using the principle of assuming good intent when you hear stuff from others. So I feel like those two principles, taken together, they seem contradictory, but when they're used in different contexts, I think that they are both very useful. And not using the code of conduct as a stick when you hear stuff, I think is probably the most productive way of using it.
Right, thank you. Erica?
I have a question, follow-up question. What would be the best practice if I find myself in a condition of being unable to assume good intent? So I'm in a situation in which I'm like, based on what I see, I do not think, I mean, I have every rational reason to believe there is no good intent on the part of that person. So I can't assume good intent, because
right.
that means I get bullied or abused.
What I've done in such situations in the past is just state that. So I'd say, I'm not sure you actually mean this very well anymore, but assuming I'm wrong, I'll answer this. And if they then still go like, whatever, then I stop the discussion. I've made my point clear at that point. That's what I feel. If they read that statement and go, oh, hang on, that's not what I meant, then they will come back and apologize, and then to me everything's fine. But I think if you clarify that what you just did to me, I don't feel good about it. In my experience, people will usually either confirm that they meant it that way, in which case to me the discussion is over, or apologize and then we can move on. And to me that works really well. I'm not saying it will work for everyone, but that's what I've done in the past.
Could there be another couple of personal stories about how to deal with such a thing, and maybe a guideline coming
That's
up?
A good idea. Anyone want to contribute?
I have had similar experiences with voicing that I don't feel that there's good intentions.
Mm-hmm.
So quite often it has turned out that there has been some misunderstanding that then gets solved. And also it has helped to often say not, like sometimes I've said instead of voicing that I don't feel there's good intentions, is kind of like pushed myself despite like emotionally feeling and kind of feeling that I rationally have every right to believe that they don't have good intentions, and gone like, there's like tiny possibility there has been a misunderstanding, so let's say that first and see what happens.
Assume good intent part, huh?
Yeah, so but at that point when I have pushed myself to do that, I totally don't feel that I can assume good intentions. It's like, yeah, you know, I know lightning sometimes strikes 5 times in the same place, so maybe this is one of those cases, but I don't truly believe that. But I've been also wondering whether there has been any cases of people just saying that, please can we continue this conversation the next day, because many conversations, they're not really that urgent that they need to be finished that day. I have never been in a situation on mailing list where I would have asked for that or seen it happen.
Right.
But this is getting sidetracked.
Yep, right.
I don't think this is getting sidetracked at all. I think a code of conduct should include these or scenarios as examples to guide the behavior.
Well, the code of conduct doesn't currently, because it was always my feeling that if you start listing things like don't do this and don't do that, you end up with an enumeration, and the lack of a particular item might make some people feel that they can do that because it's not in the list. So that's why I consciously avoided such a list. But
so I'm a dog.
Right.
Don't do anything translates into do something. Apparently dogs don't think of the negative. So you always need to use positive reinforcement.
Right.
So instead of saying don't do this, say suggestion. Perhaps ask if the conversation can be continued the next day.
Right.
So there's no don'ts, there's only suggestions.
That could work, I suppose, yeah.
Yeah.
That works with kids as well.
Yeah. So
you know that better than I do. Yeah, go ahead.
It's a quite like people.
So, don't swear, don't do this is not helpful, especially as an awful lot of the time in tech communities we swear and we don't mean any offence by it, that's just what we do. But suggesting to people, well, you know, if it's late at night, you're tired, and this conversation is getting very heated, suggest that you continue it in the morning. That's giving somebody a tool that they can use, which is not the same as an instruction at all.
Right,
it's a tool. There's a difference between a tool and an instruction.
It would be nice also if we saw this behavior modeled on the mailing list more. Like you said, I don't know that I've ever seen a conversation on a mailing list where people have said, can we have a timeout for a day?
I do this on IRC. Nowadays I haven't used it a lot, but I used it when I was much more active on IRC. I used it a lot. I had this little script alias that would basically block everything from the person for 10 minutes. And if the conversation got too personal, I would say that that can be calmed down, please, so that we can have, take a step back and have a little break from this. And if they would keep on continuing, I would say that I'll come back in 10 minutes to see if we can continue this. And it worked super well. Usually when I came back after 10 minutes, we would return to the same conversation in a much more rational way.
in the worst case, I ended up using it 3 times in a row. And then, actually, when I came back, the other person was like, sorry, I was totally out of line. Can we now return to the topic? I don't know how a similar thing would work on a mailing list.
Yeah, what I was just to say, I mean, there's a huge difference between a mailing list and IRC, where IRC is more or less live action. I say something and I can expect a reply within seconds. Whereas on the mailing list, the average response time is in a matter of hours. So if you're like, I don't feel very well now about answering this, I'm very upset about it. If you let it sit for a day without asking the other person, can I reply within a day? Well, that's certainly expected behavior, so it doesn't really make all that much difference. Yeah.
I think that's fine, but I think saying that you're uncomfortable might go some way.
That's true. But that's separate from can we wait for an hour or six.
I just want to make a comment. I've been in very hairy organizations, that's bad. And I just want to make a comment that I've been surprised being well-versed in the I'm grumpy now, I'm going to leave. And people go with it. So I think as a community, you are very well on the way, if not already there. So I think you just be encouraged by that.
Thank you for that endorsement.
I think what's a bit missing is the problem if there is a larger heated discussion. What we had now is if oneself is a bit too heated. The problem is what do you do if in larger discussions and we had some in
if
the last have, time, where there are people that seem to be for months in a quite emotional state, where you can't come near a topic, or they will claim you are a troll, or not that, or say, do you agree with that troll, and things like this. The question is, what can one do with such larger problems?
I'm not sure if we want to fix every problem. And in fact, to be fair, it's 10 years ago now that the Vancouver proposal happened, where Yale Coleman, as an observer, as a anthropologist, made the observation that through conflict, we realigned our values and we reevaluated how Debian works. It wasn't fun if you were in the midst of it, and I was in the midst of it, because as a porter of the 6K port, which was threatened with destruction at the time, obsolescence, it was very emotional for me. But Debian, through the whole Vancouver issue at the time, decided that maybe we don't need to support all ports for all time. I wouldn't have said that at the time, but I will say today that it was a good decision that we made when we made it. It wasn't fun, but I'm thinking that it's not always necessary to avoid conflict. We should try to as much as possible, but sometimes conflict is necessary. If you disagree with someone, of course, if it gets personal, that's a different matter. But technical conflicts may also get emotional and may also be difficult, but we shouldn't go out of the way to avoid it at all, right? If you see what I mean.
Yes, but I'm especially speaking about a large-scale discussion where it's obvious that a technical discussion because no one looks for technical discussion, or if someone tries, he is still shouted as a troll and go away.
Right. That's a good question. I'm not sure how to answer that one. Yep.
So I'm wondering if anyone can think of examples where, so I know they're not as spectacular, but where some kind of conflict has been resolved with, with everybody kind of happy, or at least not very upset. So in terms of, so there's been some suggestions about changes to be made, and so some of the suggestions have been good, but so you mentioned basing it off of mailing lists. If there have been actual examples of where things have actually worked, can anyone think of
The usual way in which I see things function correctly, when there's a conflict and there's a resolution, is when both you somehow get the other side let's say one side's being pressuresome, right? Getting them to or asking them to try to empathize with your position and you empathizing with their position. In other words, trying to understand each other and actually come to a resolution that works rather than basically, you know, shouting no in both directions, if that helps.
That is a very good proposition. Unfortunately, it only works if both sides do it.
That's right.
And it's been my experience that it is a skill that unfortunately some people just don't have.
That's true.
And so you can try it, but it's not always going to work, I think.
I've had this happen with people who are actually close to me.
Right.
And in those situations, it's rather difficult because you don't actually want to yell at them. You don't actually want to close the door.
Right.
So usually what I would try to do is to let them know that what they're saying is unacceptable, or in some way actually confront them but not actually attack back.
Right.
So to be with some force but yet not being overwhelming, and trying to get the other person to get to understand where I'm coming from and why what they're doing is being a problem.
Right.
And usually lately that's usually worked.
Okay. Thank you. Any of you were saying?
So I like your point, and it's been pointed out to me that if you want to solve a problem, there's no point looking at where the problem is, but where it isn't, and figure out what are they doing right. I think you're looking in the right direction. Unfortunately, it's pretty hard to remember good examples because the bad ones are more memorable.
That's absolutely true.
But I think we have at least one memorable good example in Debian, which is the discussion about the diversity statement, in which at the beginning everyone was like, oh my god, it's going to be so... And then the discussion was on for a month of excellent discussion, and it came out with a wonderful document. What was the pattern in that? I don't know. Possibly one thing is that the discussion had a person who took care of leading it and summarizing it somehow, so it didn't just drift. Maybe that is a pattern, and that person was quite respected.
Yeah, I think that is actually, if there's something you really care about, this a discussion that I started on Dash Devil a while back, about facilitating external repositories, that thing. And there have been a few mails in there, like very long mails with arguments, somewhat going sarcastic and ironic, stuff like that, which I could have interpreted as flame bait, but I decided not to. And I think, of course I can't tell what would have happened had I not interpreted it that way. But I feel that by replying in as reasonable manner as possible, the sarcasm and the sting got out of the discussion, and that can help as well. So it's always...
That's assuming good faith, I understand.
That's the part of assuming good faith. It's also the part of ignoring the flame bait. That's just my... Whatever. It's also the part of ignoring the flame bait and not giving in to the temptation of replying to bad intentions with bad intentions.
Right.
Which also helps. Right. Emiko?
I think I was thinking about communication in lists, where it has trickier bits than IRC, because, for example, there's no concept of let's discuss it again tomorrow, because we span all the time zones.
Right.
And there's no such thing that we have it's a continuous day.
Right.
And you also may read the mail, let's continue tomorrow, after you reply to the mail already, because you were behind a couple of mails.
And I get there tomorrow, and the discussion has drifted to all sorts of things, and I need to read like 50 emails. But an interesting thing is that splitting the level of the content of the topic of the conversation with the level of the meta communication. So I wonder if there could be a suggestion of try to agree with what the other person, the needs of the other person in the communication, even if you don't agree with the point they're trying to make.
Right.
So if I say, I think we shouldn't have a graphical installer, people may disagree with me.
Right.
But if I say, I would like to take some time off this discussion and come to you later with why I think the graphical installer shouldn't be there. I have two things. Like I'm saying I'm not in a condition of participating in the discussion to the best of my abilities at the moment, but
right.
I care about that topic. And one can take me seriously, kind of agree with me on that bit and figure out, so when would you have time to discuss this? Would you like to write down a proposal for it and come back to me? So that they can agree with that without agreeing with what I want.
I see what you mean.
And it's not obvious in such a discussion that one can agree with one but not the other. It's like, I disagree with you, therefore everything you say in an email is wrong.
Right, yeah. I have seen that kind of behavior, and sometimes it's annoying, but I see what you mean. It could probably... It usually... I've also had cases where I say I'm going to come back to this later, and then it meets a month later, say, well, this is why I think it doesn't work. And because of the medium of email, you can actually do that, because you can always go back and refresh, which is difficult with things like RSC. Anyone else want to contribute something?
So a large part of the reason why I feel comfortable coming here is because you have a diversity statement in the code of conduct.
Uh-huh.
So I'm very glad that you do, and please don't take it away. But I understand that these tools need to be reformed somehow. Something else people have talked a lot about, conversations getting heated. It might be helpful to remember that when you're talking technical stuff and people are getting angry, it's because they care.
Right, right. That's right. I think that's a good note to end on, because we're about to run out of time. Maybe one more?
I have one proposal. It might make sense to add a link to some text about Harvard's principles negotiation to the code of conduct, because it's a way of, it has a lot of good advice about how to separate people from the problem. It's a system that is described by a book written by a couple of people who have been involved in international diplomatic negotiations, so...
Where I'm sure emotions get much higher.
Yeah.
I have a question with respect to your remark. You said we agree on that these topics are, or that they should be revised. Is that something that we agree on? Because
I'm not sure if we do. Yeah.
Now, the way that I heard you was that there should be tools added to help implement this.
Yes. Clarity, not much from the point, sorry. So you should definitely have a diversity statement, you should definitely have a code of conduct. That doesn't mean that they are carved into the surface of granite.
Right,
they can be
right.
revised from time to time.
Right, yeah, just to be clear about this, I want to evaluate what we have. I'm not necessarily sure myself we need to revise it. And in fact, if the result of the discussion is that we think we should revise it, I'm not going to be the one to drive it, because I've been giving it as it is right now, and I feel it should be somebody else's job.
I've got one proposal when changing code of conduct, because I agree with you that we need to avoid having it just list, do this, do this. So maybe it would be something nice to have something similar, like there are the laws, and then there are comments from judges, from different lawyers. So maybe do something like this, like code of conduct, like the judge. Rules or something like this, and then put additional addendum to code of conduct when
right.
you could.
It's maybe
some advices, some.
It's maybe important
to
sorry. It's maybe important to remember in that context that the rules that we decided on for the code of conduct is that the while we cannot change the code of conduct except through GR, the DPL does have the ability to add a further reading link at the bottom. So if you think we should add something that is valuable to in the context of the code of conduct, it might be good to explore that option. We haven't used it yet. That doesn't mean we can't, right? Daniel first, and Phil.
So I just wanted to point out that we do have a culture within Debian of people writing documentation for other people to use to interpret the, you know, social contract and the DFSG and things
right.
without being part of the social contract and the DFSG. And in many ways, the things that people reference the most that have been written about those are things that someone has written on the side.
Right.
And those
right.
then become incorporated by practice at the community. So if we have people who, I mean, you just gave an example of, you know, a reference that we should link to, and you know, I'm sorry, I don't know your name.
I'm Bernardo in the bio.
Okay, so you gave an example of you know specific actions people can take to try to align their work with it. It would be great to have those written down, even if they're not directly linked to from the code of conduct right now. You know, as a community, we can point to them and say, here's some examples of how to do this stuff, right?
And I think that a denim is a brilliant idea.
Yeah.
Because code of conduct are probably by definition dry and boring.
Right.
you know, and then if you can link, you can go to some things feel like they resonate with you, and then you can link to them. Like that's
right.
the wonder of
it. Right. That's why I made it possible to do that. Actually, Phil, you wanted to say something?
Yeah. I think there is in my experience a certain problem with. Not the code of conduct, but the way that a complaint might be interpreted depending on the context and who the complaint is about and who the complaint is from. And at the moment, it's in American law, there's a concept of vexatious litigation, where if you start suing everybody in your town, eventually the courts get pissed off at you. they just throw your case out and say, next time we see you, unless it's someone, you know, having a go at you, or if it's as long as it's not you suing people for having blue cards, then it's okay. But otherwise, you're in jail. And
right.
so it's possible that if someone has complained about everybody in a discussion that doesn't agree with them, then you don't have to take the last of those complaints seriously, as if it's the first time they've complained.
Right. Right.
And I don't think we've got
this.
That.
This goes yeah. back to
we don't
seem
to have that. Wait a second.
Sorry.
You know, we should definitely. I'm not saying wait a second. You. It's in the process. There's not a. It's not a wait a second thing where, you know, if someone complains for the first time, that's a big thing. To overcome the inertia of sort of thinking, well, this is just the community. Everybody would hate me for complaining. If you feel like you should complain, you should complain. And you've overcome quite a hurdle to do that the first time.
Mm-hmm.
If it's your 17th complaint that day, and your 20th, that I don't think that's ever happened, but if that did happen, then we really ought to have a process so that the people that end up being interested in this have an interest in protecting the victims. And that's completely right. Because if you're privileged, and you know, you're not going to spend all the time trawling through this crap that you might have to put up with from both sides. Because you're going to get attacked by both sides when you're trying to sort this stuff out. You're not going to do it. So the people that do it are, of course, going to be favouring the victim quite heavily. But there is a point at which the victim isn't actually the victim. They're just sort of machine-going people with their handle.
I actually think that it's not an unreasonable interpretation of the code of conduct, of this part of the code of conduct. To say that if you start abusing the code of conduct and spewing it at everyone, you are in breach of this part that says that you should adhere to the relevant parts of the code of conduct, that you are no longer respecting other people and not assuming good faith and stuff like that. Of course, that might be a bit of a weird interpretation, but I think it fits. Yeah, right.
I want to go to the second paragraph, series of of that. Of
oh, sorry.
Series of persistent offenders may be banned. That's fine, but I want to know, is there a follow-up process to understand why there are serious or persistent offenders? Because I'm assuming that these people already have a history in Debian, that they're not some random troll that's just coming in to spam you.
Right.
There are some random trolls.
And if I can, okay, well then those are easy. Like, you know.
And I have a personal, I was one of those persistent offenders as I was going into a nervous breakdown. And yes, I was banned, but I also had our head of department coming to me and had a private conversation with me to find out what was actually wrong. And I think that solved the cause of the problem much better than just banning you would ever have done. And so I think a bit of sympathy there would be, you know, from a public message ban, that's a procedure, that's fine.
Right,
but
right.
From the back end, come in and find out why it's actually happening. I think you can resolve a lot of things.
That's an interpersonal thing that I think we can hard, that I think is hard
I
to put
think
a procedure.
That in the cases I know about, there's always been someone or several someones that have tried to get in touch with the person via private channels, and the trouble is that normally, if they, you know, people don't normally go completely potty on, depends on their personality, but people normally don't do it on Debian because of Debian. They do it because they're going through a divorce, or they're, they've just been diagnosed with cancer, or whatever. And so they're stressed about, you know, all their ability to deal with stress is taken up with that other thing. And then someone says something that can, you know, they read the first sentence of a post, the person that sent it, or they reading it, misses the knot towards the end of the line. And the rest of the post means something completely different, and they respond with flamethrowers, and and then that's the end of that.
We have actually very few cases of people being thrown out, and those cases were quite spectacular. And they had extensive in normal channel, side channel negotiation before. Possibly a problem of those cases is that there's been way too much attempts not to get to that, where it could have been like, please get out of the project and
right.
come back after a year after
right.
things may get better. But in all of those cases, in all of the cases in the past that I can think of, except one, there would be no problem if the person came back. And I think the general attitude would be, oh, let's get to know each other again.
Right. Well, I can think of two, but okay, details. I think that is usually the case. And that's why it also says temporary or permanently. And why it doesn't go into detail on when we do one or the other, because I don't think that makes sense in any kind of procedure anyway. So, it should be the exception anyway, and I think it currently is, which is good. Do we have anything more to say, or yeah, Carson?
May answer to that. We've had at least two cases in which I know where people haven't been thrown out formally. But where there have been heavily suggested to resign themselves in a form which made very clear that if they do not resign for themselves, one will kick them out.
We had one person being kicked out at DEFCON 6. I'm not going to name names, but he was kicked out during DEFCON 3. And we had one person being banned and effectively kicked out. From analysts. I'm also not going to name him, but this was a personal conflict. That's the two names I can think of. There are other people who have been temporarily banned as well. Many more of those, I'm sure.
There's been people who have been invited to leave.
Right, yeah, I'm sure.
But the general thing is that we can't really kick a person out. We can revoke official membership and say, we don't think you are an official part of the project because you're not following, we're not interacting contractually with the rest of the project. Or you act in a way that contradicts the foundation documents of the project that you signed, and you've shown no way of acknowledging this. That's why accounts have been closed. But even in the case of accounts being closed, some of the people are still contributing to Debian in their own way, in other forms. It could be that they could not contribute according to how Debian works, but they still contribute, and maybe not together with people that are happy to work with them, and that is working fine. So I thought so far the kicking out, I mean the post kicking out part, let's say, does leave doors open, unless there's some spectacular door slamming happening, in which case we can reconsider things after a bunch of years.
Right.
Can I conclude for the minutes that you are generally happy with the post kicking out procedure?
Well, my gut feeling is that it's not so bad, but I'm also in a position such that if people have a problem with that, they probably wouldn't complain to me.
I think we can conclude on this. We're almost out of time anyway, so we don't have time to move on to anything else. I do encourage you, if you feel we should take some action, to maybe post something on the Dev Project Mail list, because this is really only a very small subset of the project anyway. We do have ways to add links to the Code of Conduct fairly easily, so if you think that's a reasonable thing to do, go ahead and try to get that on. As I said, I don't think I should be the one leading this anymore, because I've already done this, and it would be bad for me to do everything. But other than that, thank you for being here for this discussion.